Welcome to Sweet Adeline's International Zoom Chats 2020. Our guest today is going to make a royal difference in the way you sing. Patty Cobb Baker is a professional voice teacher and vocal coach who became a member of Sweet Adeline's in 1983. She's the vocal education coordinator for the two-time international champion chorus, Harbor Lights, and a member of the International and Regional 21 faculty. Patty is also a member of the Education Direction Committee, the Finance Committee, and she serves as chair of the Board Resource Advisory Committee as well. She's a member of the International Board and is currently serving as our immediate past president. Patty is also the tenor of the 2013 Sweet Adeline's International Champion Quartet Touché and the tenor of our 2020 Sweet Adeline's International Champion Quartet Viva. She lives in Missouri, Texas with her two fur babies, Max and Oliver, and we are so fortunate to have her Zooming in with us today. Hi, Patty Cobb Baker.
Good morning, Miss Renee, how are you?
I'm doing well. We're very glad to have you in our Zoom chat room today. Oh, and the topic is delicious. So you're going to share with us, if we were all going to be our own voice teacher, you're going to tell us how to do that, right?
Absolutely.
All right, go for it.
My favorite thing to talk about. I love to talk about singing and how really it's not as complicated as we make it. And one of the things I say in a lot of my vocal production classes is that many people know that I used to work for NASA. I began my career as a, not a rocket scientist, but as a program analyst, which was doing all the financial stuff, cost analysis and all that kind of stuff. I'd like to say that I worked for the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. And a lot of people say, well, you know, air and space. Well, and now I say, well, now that I'm a voice teacher, I still work in air and space, because singing is really pretty simply can be broken down to that. Now, yes, there's a lot more to technique than that, but those are the fundamentals that are fairly easy if we spend some time working on them, grasping and from them.
Breathing should be normal, but it's hard.
I know, everybody thinks that. And
are you gonna help me make it easy? Because I might kind of.
Yes, it is simple. It is nothing more. I call breathing going on vacation. It is the moment when after you've done all your singing stuff, you go on vacation for a second, relax. And when you do that, and you open everything up, the air just drops right in. Well, I worked for NASA. I was in finance. I have a degree in public administration. I do not have a degree in music, yet I'm a voice teacher now. How did that happen? Well, I was singing from the very minute I came out of the womb. So my parents gave me voice lessons when I was a kid, which of course I didn't want to do because I wanted to be a cheerleader instead. And so I quit, and then, but I was still in love with singing. So the minute I got out of college, I started taking voice lessons again. And then I found Sweet Adeline's. And in Sweet Adeline's, I got into quartetting. And then in quartetting, you know, that's where you get the best coaching individually. I mean, we get great instruction, group instruction from our choruses, but when you get in a quartet, that's when you're going to get honed in on. Yeah. I had this amazing teacher, coach for our quartet, my very first quartet, and she gave us some exercises that were really weird to my 30-year-old self at the time. They were real, and I was singing lead then, not tenor. They were really dark. They were like, you had to hold your jaw down and you had to sing, yo-ho, really dark, really crazy, really kind of crazy. They were basically to get us in touch with our resonating spaces. And I said, well, I've been singing this way my whole life, and I don't think I can change that. You know, I can't change that. And she just went, in her very patient voice teacher way, just try. And I did. I said, I was game. You know, I was game for anything. I'm here to tell you. So this is my first quartet. We had competed once before we started working with her. We were like, I don't even remember, seventh or eighth in our first contest. We won the next contest. Whoa. All of us were doing those exercises. And I was like, you mean I can control the way my voice sounds? I can change? This is my first light bulb moment from a Sweet Adeline teacher
I love it. What were the exercises? I want to know.
They were by a guy named Thomas Blaylock. And I don't even know if you can still find them. I still have them and I still use them with some of my students when I really want them to first experience, you know, building some resonance, or building that resonance. And they were amazing. They get the jaw and all that kind of stuff out of the way. But it was really my first time where I realized, wow, we have control over the instrument. We're not just given a voice when we're born and that's it. So when I moved to California and opened my own voice studio and Harbor Lights wanted me to do Vocal Gold, that's when I took even a deeper dive and just all the self-study in the whole world. I must have 200 books on singing that I probably haven't even read, but only half of them. But I learned what an amazing instrument our voice really, really is. Yes. And what we're capable of doing with it. So the class that I teach on being your own voice teacher basically is adopt the system, you know, work on the fundamentals first, you know, breathing, making sure you have an open throat when you start your sound phonation, making sure then that you've got all your resonators open and that you're using all of them and what that feels like. Then working your way into making sure you can sing all the right notes, all the notes in your range smoothly and consistently, and then working into the articulating skills and word sounds. And if you work from that hierarchy from the bottom up, all with the positive mindset, a relaxed instrument, you can really be your own voice teacher. And now is the perfect time when we have all this time when we're singing by ourselves. To do those kinds of deep dives. And with the advent of the internet, see, I had to buy books when I was learning all of this stuff. You know, now you could just hop online and there are videos, amazing voice instruction videos. We're putting some amazing one. I just reviewed some more by Kim Vaughn yesterday that are amazing. They're like getting your own voice lesson. You can be your own voice teacher. You can learn all this on your own.
So how do we get past listening to the voice we hear inside our head as we sing? We're very used to our own voice. So how do we know if we're doing it correctly in studying that hierarchy?
Okay, so it is good to get feedback when you're first learning. My teacher in Houston, whose studio I started teaching at, she, again, this was even before telephones that could record your voice and all that stuff. She had a reel-to-reel, and she was a band singer, and she had a great voice. And she said as she was learning how to use her own voice, she would record herself reel-to-reel, so you can imagine what a pain that was, and then listen back. And then she would do something else, like she would change her space, or she would try to do it real forward or real back, or she would do an inflection, or she would play it back and listen. Well, the things she liked best, she replicated, okay. Right?
And we could even videotape ourselves at home.
Exactly.
Watch what we're doing with our bodies as we sing.
Exactly. A mirror is your best friend when you are your own voice teacher, and you can easily do it again, like you said, on these calls. And it's very simple to get feedback from your section leader or from your director or from your favorite voice teacher on Zoom. And they are happy to just listen in on you and give you feedback when you're, is this what you're looking for? Now, the thing about listening to ourselves, we are ensemble harmony singers. And so we are really in tune to using our ears. But we have to understand that our ears are, first of all, behind the source of our sound. So they get a delayed reaction to what we're doing. Oh. And they're muffled by all the bones and muscles in our head getting to those ears as well. So we can't always trust what we hear, which is why we need to become sensory singers. We need to base our singing on what we are feeling, not what we are hearing.
Okay.
And again, that's what my teacher, Debbie, who was this band singer, I mean, I'm talking about rock band. She said, I could never hear myself on stage because I was in front of the speakers that were projecting all the sound. She said, I had to learn to sing based on what I was feeling inside here. And also how you feel the use of the air, you know, in your body as well. When I sing now, after I've done all the prep work of learning my music and how that vocal line needs to feel inside of me, all I think about, I turn that performance on and all I'm doing is I am sensing the air that I'm using and how it's feeling in my instrument and does it feel right. And I might occasionally think, okay, here comes that big jump. I have to remember to give myself a little extra support here, or I need to get into my rib cage a little bit more or whatever for breath support. But usually I'm just turning it on, letting what I've worked on go and just sensing. I'm like a little computer, sensing, is everything going okay? So that then I can do what you trained me to do, which is tell the story. I was worried about all of us and whether or not we were doing what the sound right. coach had just told us to do in our last yep. performance. And you said to me, Patty, if you keep doing that, you're never going to win. And that was the moment where I realized she's right. And I'm going to let these other three people down because of my hangups.
Well, your thought process showed on your face. And
you were
watching a ticker tape go by of the things that you knew needed to be happening. So it was managing what you were producing instead of.
Yeah, it was that. A pivotal moment for me. And it was like all of a sudden my mind went back to, why do you do this, Patty? Why do you do this? And I had an image of me on a swing set with my brother back when we were children. I was probably under 6 years of age, swinging on the swing, singing together, a song, you know, oh, how I love to go up in the sky, up in the, you know, anyway, and how joyful that was and how much I loved singing. I would sing myself to sleep at night in bed. I would sing at the dinner table. No singing at the table was one of our rules. But I said, I'm never going to do that again. I'm only going to sing from the joy of it. And it was hard.
Yeah. It's work, but it's rewarding. But if you like allergies or any reason that you have a little bit of stuffiness or your ears are a little bit muffled, you sing better because you can't listen.
That's right.
And we do a lot of things like
any kind of excess nasality that you might be trying to.
You have to sing around it. Yeah. It
enables that. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So breathing, what's your suggestion for learning how to breathe with relaxation? Because I don't think that personally, it's a little vacation for me. So I want to learn how to do that.
Okay, so it's practice. When we inhale, our body relaxes and it enables the diaphragm. The diaphragm's going to move down and it enables it to move down without any of our tight abdominal muscles being in the way. And so what I would learn to do is to relax those abdominal muscles. And my teacher would say, think about the muscles all the way down to where your legs join at the torso. So I would sit on the floor. I like to sit in like a yoga position, but you don't have to. You can sit in a chair or wherever. Before I would go to bed at night, and I would it's very meditative. I would just kind of close my eyes and I would take a breath through a pursed lip. So I would take it in like, and I would just allow every bit of my body. I would just be thinking, how low can I let these muscles open up to that breath? How many of these muscles can I just relax all the way down to where my legs attach to my body? And then I would, and then once I was full, comfortably full, not, you know, I don't go to a point where I would start to feel tense or tight. Comfortably full, then I would immediately just let it out. It needs to be like the waves in the ocean. So I'd have this image of the waves come in, the breath comes in. And then the waves immediately go out. The breath has to immediately go out. And so learning to breathe full, you know, with that relaxed body, in a very slow way like this, so your body can memorize what this feels like, so that your body learns that when I take a breath in, everything lets go and relaxes, and then I don't stop, and then as soon as I'm ready to go, I let that air go, and it goes until it's gone. So it's just all very organic.
So just a couple weeks of that.
Yeah. Then in my practice, when I would do my vocalizing or at course, all I would think about is, am I doing what that felt like when I was doing my my nighttime ritual. Am I replicating that? And I just, all I would think about, how is my body working on this breath? And am I using it all that same way?
Okay.
So when you learn it slowly, it gives your body an opportunity to really memorize what you're asking it to do. And you have to do it many, many times for that neural pathway to build right. to the muscles.
And then as we are getting to the end of having air, what's the best tip to keep from trying to squeeze all those muscles to get the last bit of air out? Because that actually works against us.
It totally works against us. So again, you have to be your own sensor. You have to start to sense when you feel you are getting tight. When you are getting tight, that means breathe.
Yeah.
Don't go any further than that beginning feeling of getting tight, because the minute you go to get tight, it goes here.
Right.
So in chorus, that means putting together a breath plan, a personal breath plan, which we can do.
Mm-hmm.
We are allowed to breathe anywhere. My favorite quote of a singer, it was from Ethel Merman, and it was, she says, "I breathe when I have to."
Yes.
Somebody must have asked her about a question about
breathing.
How do you do that? I breathe when I have to. You know, air is there for us. It's free. You put your breath plans together and they are under ideal conditions.
Right.
And that you might get on stage and a little bit of nerves might creep in, or excitement, I like to call it. It's just excitement, it's not nerves. And you might just need an extra little breath somewhere. And I've never gotten a comment that, you know, I heard you take a giant breath. But again, breathing is the moment that you let your body go and relax. And then, because truly there's four phases of breathing for singing. There's inhalation, suspension, that moment right before we begin to create sound where you know, all of our supporting muscles set us up. Exhalation, and the last, the term they use, the last phase is recovery.
Oh, wait, say those again.
It's inhalation,
okay.
Suspension, exhalation, recovery. And that's what taking that breath is.
Okay.
It's recovering from all that you've just done. So you really do need to just let everything go and let that breath come back in and then set it right back up and go. And it's all very fluid, very fluid.
It's just that easy.
It's so easy. But no, you have to put your attention on it for a dedicated period of time. You can generally master it. I can remember working on my tongue because I had what my teacher called a pickle tongue that liked to pull up and not want to lay flat. I worked on my tongue for 2 weeks, just, you know, making sure I could act, you know, feel what a relaxed tongue felt like and get that tongue to relax down. I worked on certain phonation things for forever. You know, you just focus in on it for a while and you'll master it. You really will.
If we break it down into smaller pieces, we have so much education offered to us in Sweet Adelines. And if we break it down personally to smaller goals and work on those things, particularly now when we're singing by ourselves, then we're going to start to create, you said, a neural pathway to training the body, right?
Yeah, because singing is all about coordinating muscle sets.
Mm-hmm.
Just like we call ourselves athletes. It is like a sport, because that's what athletes do. They coordinate muscle sets in different ones, and that's what we're learning to do. And you have to take it slowly. You have to take it step by step, just like they do. Just like they do. Same thing with, you know, learning to play an instrument.
Mm-hmm.
You don't pick up an instrument and immediately start being an expert at it. People seem to think that when you have a good voice or you're born with the ability to, you know, what I always say, carry a tune in a bucket, that you should be able to just do anything with it. No, we have to learn to use it, just like everyone has to learn any instrument.
So what's your favorite warm-up? What's the thing you start with?
I love bubbles to get my air moving and to get just this all very relaxed.
Tickles my nose.
I know, it tickles people's nose. And I know some people are bubble challenged, and that's okay. You can learn to bubble. Again, it just takes a little bit of practice. But
so you do it low down? I mean, because I'm picturing you in the stratosphere, but you can't start that way every day, right? So you start low, or?
I like to start in the mid-range, in your speaking range. I always start mid-range and I move down. So my favorite bubble is, because this also works on the relaxed breath, is
okay.
And then I say, go on vacation, take a relaxed breath before you do the next one. So again, when you're working any vocalese, that's when you're not just working that particular vocalese and what it's meant to do for your voice. You're working on every breath you take, and you're working on relaxing, taking a complete comfortable breath between each one.
Right. And we don't need a lot of volume when
we're starting. We don't need volume. So I move, I move down the scale first.
Okay.
And by the way, that's my favorite exercise for a pitched tone to start out with. I even start out before that with just stretches and then, yawn sighs, doing like several minutes of those while you're in the shower with all that wonderful steam in there is fabulous for the voice. And just, you know, just making the kinds of sounds babies make, basically. Very free, where you're not controlling anything.
Right. I often think that the people that work in a hotel when we're having a convention, if they're walking up and down the halls in the morning, they have to be just going, what is going on here?
Happening?
What? Everybody's in all the rooms. I mean, I love it. It's one of my favorite things if you're just walking in a hall and you hear somebody. But we've got to be able to, and we should be doing that right now, even though a lot of us are struggling a little bit with the motivation to sing every day. I mean, we intend to, but then maybe we're not taking as much care of our voice right now as we should.
We do not need to be taking a year off from singing, people, you know, during this COVID. We need to be taking this time, you know, getting at those chorus rehearsals, doing those warm-ups, recording them, and then using them every day.
I mean, for most of us, we're like you. We can't remember not singing.
Right.
So right now, even if it's challenging, we've got to be doing a little vocalization every day.
Every day. And it doesn't have to be like where you're sitting at your piano doing scales for a half an hour or an hour. It's 10, 15 minutes here, 10, 15 minutes there. I mean, it's good that I live alone because I make all sorts of noises all day long. I am singing, I am making up exercises. When it's time to feed the dogs, here comes the newest song about chicken. I mean, I am singing all day long. All day long.
I've heard people talk about too, picking your favorite vowel, like finding your favorite vowel to vocalize on at whatever range is comfortable for your voice. And I know mine is an E.
Me too.
I don't, is it?
Yes.
And I like to do, I just love to do E.
Beautiful.
And I never, thank you. And I never add volume to that one.
No.
And so I can move up and down. A lot of times I'll just stay right in that spot. Whatever note comes out when I just take a breath and sing.
Right.
It's the most relaxed place for my range. And just to get those little half steps up and down and keep the volume from increasing or feeling like I'm adding anything in creating that sound. Because when we dance and when we do all the stuff that we do and have the adrenaline flood the way you were describing, the excitement, you know, the muscles do some different things. So that's... Yeah. That's my favorite. I mean, a lot of people, you can do you can do ooh, you can do lips closed, lips open. What comes the most naturally if you say to somebody, just hum or just sing something. And then they kind of find that spot that their voice functions without having to work at it.
Exactly. And you can make up your own vocal exercises to work whatever challenge you might be having. Again, what feels good for you. And as long as you are keeping these muscles and things stretched out and relaxed, you just don't want them to atrophy, you don't want them to become tight or rigid. Gravity and time will do all those bad things for us. We need to fight against that. It's the never-ending battle. But just little things that you can do, and just If you love bubbling like I do, or even using the a tongue trill, or even just a zzz, if those other two are hard, just doing your music, just going through your chorus songs on a bubble, will help keep. That's one great way to learn what the breath plan really is that you need, because bubbles, you have to really use your breath to bubble, And it just keeps them fresh in your mind. It keeps your voice relaxed and but still warm and used. And there's lots of things that you can do all on your own to continue just making this instrument happy and healthy.
You would recommend, we could either take online voice lessons, but there are a lot of tools out there. The Sweet Adeline website has them. And there's also all kinds of, you know, videos out there with specific, addressing specific things in keeping the voice flexible, especially right now when we're not singing every week.
Right. Yeah, the Sing Baby Sing, and I don't get a kickback by promoting these, but there's all the Sing Baby Sing CDs and the book that accompanies them is an amazing tool. It lays it out. It puts together like a series of lessons over a certain amount of time. And then it also categorizes exercises by the skill that you're working on, whether it be resonance or breathing. So it's an amazing tool. But I love the, there's a woman named Cheryl Porter who's on YouTube, and she is
great.
She's the kick in the pants. She's amazing, but I love singing along with her exercises. Some of them are kind of tricky and advanced, but there are just hundreds and hundreds of them everywhere. But like I said, our website, the Kim Vaughn ones are amazing. All of Kathleen Hansen things are great, and there's even more coming, so.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much for giving us a little window into how we can be our own voice teacher. It was very fun having you in the Zoom room today, and we appreciate you sharing your time with us.
Oh, you're so welcome. It was my pleasure. Loved being with you, Renee.
Hope to see you soon.
Me too, sweetie.
Bye.
Bye-bye.